Hello? Okay, thank you. I want to welcome you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to this time of worship, especially if you are here for Ethel Tanner, because we have a big crowd here for Ethel today, and of course, Frank, he's got faith with him, so to be recognized and welcomed as new members into the life of the church. But we are glad that we're all here for the glory of God, for the experience of the Holy Spirit, for coming together to worship and to share in our experience of connecting with one another. And so today we begin a theme for the year, but also a smaller theme for a short sermon series. But the theme is home. Thinking about the whole year and through the lens of home. What does it mean to belong to a place or a group of people or to ourselves or to God in authentic ways? Who we are, to bring who we are, to be in that fullness of life. What does it mean to belong? And where is home for us? And so the invitation is that we will journey together to connect to our inner homes, but also to the experience of community and to the universe and to God and to eternity. As we are thinking of this to begin with, in addition to this happened to be the Sunday that I was asking which Sunday would work for you, Ethel, to do this recognition. And then Frank agreed to this Sunday. I didn't think of the coincidence being, you know, this claiming this church as part of their home. But we're looking at the larger picture of home, the universe being our home. We tend to think of home in the smaller ways of life. But in a larger sense of life, we belong to the whole created world. And that's kind of part of our story, our origin story. And we will be using this book as a guide by James Conlon. It's called Beauty, Wonder, and Belonging. And so it's about prayers and connections to that experience of being part of God's world. And so as we prepare our hearts for that, today we will be using a variation on the Lord's Prayer. It's an interpretation of, from the Center for Christogenesis. So this is a center that does a lot with cosmos kind of theology and understanding of God and humanity and life through the eyes of looking at the universal Christ being larger than just our human experience. And we will later use the traditional words of the Lord's Prayer. And the reason I printed those for you is to take them home and to see, to try, especially if you use the Lord's Prayer as part of your daily prayer, to open up and let it speak to you in a different way through the different translation. So we'll use that as our gathering prayer. So I invite you to take a deep breath and prepare your hearts for worship. And please join me in the gathering prayer. O creative breath, ebbing and flowing through all forms. Moving to the heartbeat of your purpose.
Make us the embodiment of your compassion.
Fill us with your creativity. Give us the wisdom to produce and share what each one needs to grow and flourish.
Untie the tangled webs of destiny that bind us as we release others from the entanglements of a past and space.
And let us not be seduced by that which would divert us from our true purpose, but illuminate the path before us. For you are the ground of the fruitful vision.
The birthing power and the fulfillment is all together and made whole once again. Amen.
Amen. And please join me in singing hymn number 274, O God of Earth and Space, you may stand as you are able.
Thank you.
for our gratitude moment today. It is the welcoming and blessing of Ethel Tanner and Frank Strock. So Ethel, would you mind coming up here? No? Would you like to stand where you are? And Frank, would you mind coming down too? I'm making them work here. So as they make their way up here, I just want to extend a warm welcome from the, you can just stay right here, a warm welcome from the elders. They have been received as members of the church, but we recognize them today and bless them and give thanks to God for their journeys of faith. And they, I have actually interviewed Ethel a little bit about her faith journey. And we'll be putting that together for the newsletter that comes out on Wednesdays. And as part of Frank's journey as well will be shared about their faith. But I'm going to share a little bit with you today, if that's all right.
Yeah.
I'm making her nervous. What did I say, Tarula? I asked, you know, tell me about your faith and what's in your life that leads you to this step. Ethel, of course, shared about her love for God and especially the Word of God. It was really interesting to hear. I did not know this. How many times have you read the Bible?
Twice
already, and she reads it every day. And prayer is a big part of her daily living. And so that's part of the experience of, and what was amazing to me is hearing God always answers my prayers. And it's interesting because it doesn't always get answered in the way we think,
right.
But always God's presence is there. The love is infused. And I see that personally in her life and her connection to her family. She, as you can see, she has a huge family. And she, and it's, you know, it doesn't mean anything if you have a huge family, because you could have a huge family and not really connect with them too. But everybody loves Ethel. You meet Ethel and you love her because she's just got that spirit of zest and strength and being present for her children, for her grandchildren, for her family, for her friends, and her work, her sense of commitment. Frank, we'll get to you shortly. But I just, you know, I give thanks to God. It's a, you know, a marvelous thing to see. And I love the connection. Actually, after the first service, we mentioned your name. Of course, we talked about you too behind your back. But good stuff. But somebody asked me, well, tell me, oh, Kelly Mountain, of course. And that's another connection. So she's Kelly's mom, but she's also the mother of other children.
Right.
So we're very grateful for your joining the church and your commitment to the way of Christ and showing that through your love, through your prayers. And I want to ask you if you'd like to say anything to the congregation.
Not really. I'm just glad that I'm joined the church now.
Great.
I'm glad that I'm a member of the church. I've been coming here a long time.
Right. And you know what's really interesting to me is that, I mean, membership in the church, we have de-emphasized membership recently. Just saying, you know, you belong to the church. You really, the Church of Christ is bigger than being a member or not. But one thing that happened back in February, we were having the annual meeting. And so we were having it here, and I saw Ethel sitting in the chapel. I said, why are you doing that? She's like, well, I'm not a member. Oh, I was like, oh no, we gotta fix that. We gotta change that, because that's one thing that happens is that whenever we have, once a year we have a meeting and there's voting on a few things. So that's the big difference. But it is a public confession of faith, a way to say that I am committed to the way of Christ and I dedicate my life to the way of Christ. Now, anything from the family? Kelly, you want to say anything? Stephen?
No.
Yes? Come on. Grandchildren?
He's the best mother-in-law I've ever had.
Did you hear that? Did you hear that? She's the best mother-in-law I've ever had. She's only had one.
It took Don Iwanicki quite a while, but he finally got her to become a member.
Ah, so Iwanicki is behind this. Okay, great. Steve is going to say something.
What? My sister said, uh-oh. I don't know if you need to, uh-oh. I'm just wanting to say, like,
the one mom, son.
My mom is one of the strongest people I know, mm-hmm. and we love her very much.
Yeah, we're very grateful.
Thank you.
I think Chelsea needs to say something on behalf of the grandchildren. Melissa, no, but you're the oldest.
Grandma was very excited today to come and become a member, and she asked me, I think, 10 times if I was going to be here this morning.
Oh,
very excited about it, but we're very excited for her, and we're going to go celebrate great. Afterwards.
Great. Wonderful. What are you doing afterwards?
I'm going to go have lunch.
Where?
Alex's.
Okay. Just in case.
Table of
15.
It's Steve Mountain's birthday.
It's Steve Mountain's birthday. Okay. Happy birthday. Perfect. That was yesterday.
No, it was today.
Today? Okay. All right. So there's a lot of joy. Anything from the congregation? Anyone? This is your chance to ask her any questions, difficult questions. Oh, Carol, we do have somebody.
No, I cannot.
Is this on?
Yeah. Oh. I cannot believe that these people, these wonderful children, are not saying something. So I feel compelled. I have known Ethel since Stephen was a baby. Our sons are the same age, so we've gone through so many sports events, weddings together of friends. I can speak with great authority that Ethel, and I'm going to embarrass her, is one of my favorite people. I have mm-hmm. seen her go through the positive things in life, and I seen her go through tragedy, and she is just one of my role models. I was mm-hmm. thrilled when I came to church and found her sitting right here in front of me. Her husband, Bob, was one of my favorite people, mm-hmm. and Art, I'm speaking for Art also. So we've watched this wonderful family grow up, and we are blessed to have Ethel and her family
yes.
associated with this church. Thanks for coming, Ethel.
I'll just say that Ethel, in my estimation, is one of the real special people in this world. She really is.
Mm. Amen. Wow. Anybody else would like to say anything?
Thank you all.
Oh. Okay, now we get to Frank. We get to Frank, and Frank is another unique, amazing person, too. And he started writing his journey of faith, and I didn't know a lot of things about him, but it was an interesting connection that we had. Paula, do you want to say anything about that?
I just found out from
Bill. Okay, all right, hold on. It's just amazing how the Holy Spirit works.
Yes, I just found out from my brother Bill that Frank was the last person in line at my mother's calling hours. And so he heard Rula preach, and here he is.
Aha, uh-huh. Okay, all right. So you never know. And then there was time when Bill connected us, Bill Toll, who worked here as our, what was his title? Accountant, but something else. He did so much more than just accounting. He helped us a lot for several years. He carried a lot of burdens when we would mess up, and I just see him doing that. But he still loved us, despite the fact that he dealt with our messy financial practices. You know, how church and finances, sometimes they don't work well together. We want to be creative in our ways of ministry, but Bill kept us on track. But one of the gifts from Bill is that he said, you know, there's this man you would like to hear about his journey, connect with him. And at that time, Diane, his wife, was going through cancer. So it was a really difficult time, and it was towards the end. And so we connected back then, and I still remember you know, after agreeing to it, I'm like, oh, why did I agree to this? This is so, it's going to be so sad. And then I felt like it was such a treasure to my life to hear about the journey of faith and the connections and how real his faith is. And so Frank is very committed to the way of Christ in his service, in his ways of reading the Bible. Again, there's a theme here. Both of you love reading the Word of God and getting into it. And prayer is also a big theme in his life. And so he has not been here very long with us, what, a couple years? But he's already contributed so much. And actually, Frank is looking at in the fall, we're looking at doing something with prayer groups. And he's going to be helping us with that. He's kind of nudging me. We got to do something with prayer. I'm like, yes, I agree. Let's see where the Spirit leads us. So we're very grateful for his ministry and his life, but also his connection to this area. And his father was the pastor, what was it you said, in 64? In Bergen, the two churches, North Bergen and Stone Church. And so that's his connection to this area. And so this is full circle because he lives part of the time in New York City and is part of the Brick Presbyterian Church in New York City. So it's really interesting to see the combo of different things that have brought him here and how he's very committed to the way of Christ, and especially through service. And we've got Faith here. So Faith is part of the deal. She comes to church every Sunday. She probably knows all the sermons by now. So Frank, do you want to say anything to us?
Well, it's a pleasure to share with you today. If it wasn't for Bill, I probably wouldn't be here right now. And I thank you very much. I have a much smaller family, a sister in New Jersey, and in-laws in Bergen in the area. But I take all of you as my family today, and I thank you for sharing your family with me. You know, I think this is an overwhelming indication of where we, as a church, as us, as participants and members, can go with the First Presbyterian Church of Batavia. I believe in tradition, although I love the 9 o'clock service also. I believe in wonderful organ music and choirs. Yes.
Yay.
I firmly believe that there's a wonderful opportunity for all of us, and this family is a clear indication of that, of growth, not only membership-wise, but spiritually. And I think with people like Ethel and her family, you know, I really believe, you know, that there is a future right here at this church for the whole community of Batavia and the surrounding area. I love sitting in the balcony. It's where I sit when I'm in New York City with Faith, because I don't want any surprises during the service. But it gives me another perspective on this service, which and the world, as Rula will speak this morning. It just gives me a feeling of warmth. It gives me a feeling of solemnness when I look at all the stained glass, when I see how the church has changed and yet how it has since. I first came here in 1964, so you can imagine. I came here for youth groups, and it was wonderful, and it's still wonderful. And I just want all of you to continue to be part of this spiritual growth, and that I happy to share this with Ethel, and I thank you so much for being a partner in membership today.
Thank you.
God bless you.
Thank you. Anyone else would like to say anything? Choir? Melzi probably has been in contact. Oh, somebody raised their hand. Melzi's been in contact with Frank, and they're talking about music and different things that he brings from the different traditions that he's experienced in New York City.
I hope I can say this without choking up. I will try. Just seeing Ethel and Frank and the love and the Christian love, the love for each other that is shown in this church, to me, what we've just seen is really the perfect sermon.
Thank you. should not have given you the microphone. Meaning the service is done. No need for the sermon today, Rula. But you would miss out on such a beautiful sermon. And so we have a couple of gifts for you here, and this is a Bible, because I thought this is an appropriate gift, and it's called the Lectio Divina, the Bible, because it has a reflective piece, a prayer piece. So I thought it combined not only the, you know, the Word of God, but also the prayers and the invitation to meditate on the gift of the Word of God and the stories of faith. So I hope you will find it to be another tool on the journey of growing. And so let us take a moment to pray. God, we give you thanks for your life in us, for the invitation to connect with one another, to sense that bond through your Son and the gift of Christ in this community. We ask for a special blessing today on Frank and Ethel and their experience in the life of this congregation, but also their whole connection to the whole body of Christ all over the world. Help us to trust in that, help them to grow, help us to welcome their gifts, and to celebrate the joy of belonging to one another. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. And you may welcome your newest brothers and sister in Christ.
Thank you.
And so we give thanks to God. There's an invitation for you if you are interested in membership, or if you're not a member, or if you'd like to become a member, or you know someone who would like to become a member. We have the Connection Point. These are events we're having once a month or so at Pub Coffee Hub. Come and join us at 9 o'clock, and you could explore that. And so I invite you at this time to share any prayers of joy or concern that you may have. If you'd like to share something, please raise your hand, and I'll be happy to bring a microphone to you. Jean, you want to give us an update?
I've been tearing up with all the things that have been going on. My sister's surgery was Friday for pancreatic cancer at Sloan Kettering in New York City, speaking about New York City. She was up walking yesterday. She texted me this morning. She sounded great on the text, and I'm waiting to hear from her on the phone. So hopefully the pathology report will be positive. We'll see. And I did talk to my niece this morning, who is going through many different kinds of cancer. She starts her chemo on Tuesday. This is on her brain. And she sounded great, great, as great as she can, and she was very happy about my sister. So, sort of a positive day for me.
Yeah, and prayers for Deb Baker. She's
been
struggling.
Yes, Deb Baker's been sick for 2 weeks. She texted me this morning and said she couldn't come. So, prayers for her.
And an update on Mark Ross. Anybody would like to give that, or should I give it? Okay, I'll give it. So Mark Ross is having surgery on the 11th of June. So please hold him and Elaine in your prayers. There are lots of steps between now and then to prepare for the surgery, but especially for a peace of mind. And Melinda, do you want to say anything about you being here? We're glad you're here. Melinda Hay is here from Florida for about a month till the end of June. So we're grateful to reconnect and have her be part of the life of the church. So I guess you were here last Sunday, but I wasn't here. So see, you didn't consult with me about your coming. But we are very glad that you are here from Florida. Ruth, do you want to say anything about your move?
It's going well. I found most of the things that I moved. I'm still hunting for some of them, but doing fine, thank you.
So we're holding Ruth in our prayers as she continues to the transition to a new home and all what that means. Never fun. Moving is like one of the big stressors of life. I'm looking at Nancy Harris, and I'm thinking she may end up moving as well. So we'll see what the future holds. Anybody else? Any other prayers? Leslie, we've been holding you in our prayers as well.
I just want to thank all of you for all your prayers over the course of the year. It's been a long year, but your prayers have been very successful. I was telling Steve today I'm on no meds. The only thing I'm doing right now is dialysis and waiting for a kidney. I have some donors. I had a match, but unfortunately our anatomies were not quite there, so we had to deny that kidney. But I'm hopeful. I have two cousins that one we're already a match. She's going to be coming up here from Florida to do all her testing, but if that goes smoothly, then hopefully maybe by fall I'll have a kidney as well. But we have a couple people in place. So thank you again for your prayers, and hopefully I'll have good news by fall for all of you.
Amen. We are holding you in our hearts. Anyone else? Let us continue in prayer. God, we give you thanks for the gift of this day, for the gift of coming together as your people, for the gift of sharing life with all of its joys and its challenges, but especially with the gift of faith and the bond we have through your Son. So help us today as we share, as we reflect, as we open our hearts to you, to continue to grow in that love, to continue to grow in that sense of unity, and to take that sense of unity out into the world where there is brokenness and hate and anger and violence, to bring peace, love, justice, and compassion. Help us to be instruments of that peace. And when we fail, help us to confess and to allow your forgiveness to bring us new ways to live up to your example of love. And help us to forgive others when they fail us as well. God, we thank you for the gift of this day and the beauty of the earth, this time of the year. And help us to remember the majesty of your creation as a reflection of that deep love that you have for us. Now we take a few moments of silence to be in the fullness of your presence. And we continue in prayer using the words our Lord Jesus Christ taught the disciples to pray, saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Don, I'm sorry to disappoint you. I will have a brief homily. We'll make it shorter, a message. We'll do a message today, not just a full sermon. But we wouldn't want to miss out on the grace of God, especially in the Gospel of John today. That is our focus. The beginning of the Gospel of John is one of my favorite pieces in Scripture because it kind of invites you to reflect on the mystery of God, of the presence of Christ, on the beginning of creation, and what life is all about. But to begin with, we are going to reflect on this question, on these two questions. Where is home for you? And where do you really belong? Where is home for you, and where do you really belong? So I'm going to invite you to take a moment, turn to a neighbor as you are comfortable. You don't have to. If you're not sitting next to a neighbor, you may want to move closer and talk to someone. Where is home for you? So, and I'm not going to define what kind of home I'm talking about. It could be any, you could take it in any way you'd like. Interesting question for you at this time, huh? Where's home? All right. So you can continue this conversation after. You don't have to leave right away after church. So anything interesting or surprising? Yeah? Ethel, you're laughing. Tell me what you're laughing about. Home is where I live. So where you get your mail, that's where you belong, okay? So that's one way of looking at home is where I'm living right now. Have you always lived in that house?
For 50 years.
Before that, where did you live? Apartment houses by where the 400 towers, okay, are, okay, interesting. So you could, where did you grow up?
Well, I was born in Pennsylvania.
Pennsylvania, okay.
I moved up here when I was
fifth grade, okay. So you could look at all the different homes you've lived in, even though you've lived in one place for 50 years. Yes, Carol. So, yeah. Yeah. Perfect. Right. Right. So you have three homes, which is unique. And between Florida, you feel home, and Batavia, and Canada, and it's about the community for you. It's not about the building. It's not about the brick and mortar. Yes, Don.
I'm holding my home.
You're holding your home. Yes. So your wife is your home in a way. So, you know, it just could be anything, or a connection, wherever we feel like we could be ourselves. A home could be anywhere. You could be living in a tent and feel home because you feel that connection to nature.
Your body,
yes. And you know what? It's in the scriptures. It says what?
Your
The body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. Yes, your body is part of your experience here on earth, your home, whether you like it or not. I love the expression of your body is a temple, but mine, I'm treating it as a tent. So, you know, it just depends on your perspective of where you, what makes you feel connected. Anybody else here?
My dad used to say home was wherever he hung his hat.
Home is wherever he hung his hat.
He was in the service.
He was in the service. So you moved because you had to, right, military personnel usually have a hard time claiming one place as home because they have to move. Lots of people have that experience of having to leave home. And so the connection to home is part of our longing. Yet even though we may have lived in one place or feel belonging to one community or another, I think there is a longing in all of us for that eternal home. It's always there. Even though you feel like you really belong here, or you belong in your skin, or you belong in Florida, or with your spouse, or whoever, you still have that deeper longing. And that's what we're talking about, that connection. I mean, I look at Frank and think, how does he feel home all the time when he's home is New York City and then Bergen, home, Bergen, you know? I'd be, whoa, whiplash. But to him, home is that sense of community. And that's where it makes a difference, when you what you focus on. And it's not just about finding where I put the forks or, you know, my socks or whatever it is, sometimes the mechanics of home. So today the invitation is to look at the larger home. We're going to start by looking at the universe. We belong to that larger home. And as Frank said, sitting up there on, from the balcony, you see things differently. And that's what we'll be doing. Is the invitation is to look from the balcony on our lives. No matter how small your idea of home might be, today we're hoping to expand it, to think about this larger home, because I believe that that's what Jesus came to do. And I love that the Gospel of John does that for us. It doesn't start like the other Gospels. They're starting with a birth story, and these are valuable for us, but they are so specific to that time and that culture. John expands it to say, you know, it's the whole world. It's the whole world. The Word was from the beginning, so Jesus being the Word. But I want you to look at this image. Have you seen kind of renditions of this? This is the whole universe, and we're just, you know, what we know is just that one dot. That's all we know. And when you think about the, see, there's the little yellow arrow. That's what we observe. That's what we can see. But the world is so big, so massive. Sometimes you feel overwhelmed, but also it invites us to that mystery, that when we look at life, it's good to every once in a while to take that perspective. When you're going through a hard time, or you're really killing yourself in your job, or driven by something, to remember this is home too. And ultimately we return to that at some point. And I want to share with you this quote from the American Museum of Natural History. Every atom of oxygen in our lungs, of carbon in our muscles, of calcium in our bones, of iron in our blood was created inside a star before Earth was born. So to think about that, how many of you wake up in the morning and thinking, wow, I'm really connected to those stars that I observe? Any of you watched the Northern Lights recently here? Or saw pictures and were mad at yourself for going to bed and not watching? Yeah, I was one of those days. I was like, oh, how could I go to bed at 10 when this happened at midnight? But it's just reminding us of those experiences when we are really part of something larger. We've come from that, and this is from a scientific point of view, but when you think about it from a faith point of view, it's the same perspective, it's just putting it in different language. And so the language of poetry, the language of faith. So let's listen to John 1, the first five verses. And I want you to think not just of Jesus being the Word, being with from the beginning, but us as human beings. We were part of God's dream from the beginning. So in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and without him, not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. I just think that's a beautiful perspective on the story of the origin. And of course, the language is intentional here. If you see verse 1, where do we hear another place in the Bible where it's, I'm going to put Frank on the spot, those who read the Bible a lot. So where does it say in the beginning somewhere else? Genesis. Okay, I knew you would know that one. See, I could have done that to you, Ethel. But think about that. In the beginning, telling us in the beginning of time. So this is reminding us Jesus' story is not just about that time and culture in the Middle East and Joseph and Mary and all the people that were involved, but it's about us. It's about this whole human experience, this whole universe, this whole vision of life. I love one of the translations. Actually, for about 300 years, the translation for the Word was actually conversation. So think about that. So there was a conversation. So it's always about a community, whether it's conversation with in the God being, you know, when we think of God, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. But it could also be about the community of creation. So from the beginning, we know that this is where our story begins and that we are people of eternity. We don't just belong here. This is not just who we are. This is part of who we are. It's kind of like Ethel having the home right now. She claims for 50 years, this is my home on Bank Street. I'll give them your address in a minute. but she makes a mean pie. I've heard about the pie. But think about that. Actually, the pie experience is incredible when you think about it. You know, when you, if you've ever had a special meal with your family, any kind of scent, when you smell that pie, it just makes you feel home. You don't have to be home. You could be in a different country. You could be in London visiting family, and you have something that reminds you of the smell of home, and it just hits home for you. And so, yet, part of that is that you have those specific experiences. Jesus was born not just in any time, at any place. He was born in that place in the Middle East and, you know, in Bethlehem, and we talk about the Joseph and Mary. We could talk about Augustus. We got to talk about the empire and the experiences of the Jewish people and all of that. And oftentimes you hear me talk about exile. Carol, what's the other thing I often talk about? Exile and what? Never mind. Okay, Exodus and exile. Those are the two big themes in the Old Testament. But these are the things, she always quotes it, but now I made her panic, so she forgot. So these are specific experiences, yet we also look behind, you know, your origins. Where did you come from? I mean, when you think about it, where do we come from? We come from eternity, and we will return to eternity, and that's the power of this story for us to remember. So I want to invite you to look for a moment at these two images. One is with the flags and the countries. Sarah actually put it this way for us. You know, you see all the different countries and cultures and the divisions that we have as human beings. And by the way, if you are like me, you know, you studied those maps when you were growing up, good luck, because they've changed so much. The world has changed so much. And the countries, some of the countries have changed names, not only, you know, boundaries, but names. But that kind of gives you a sense of that, you know, how we see ourselves sometimes. But this image gives us a different perspective. There are no, you know, borders and people divided in this land or that land. There's this bigger picture. And most people who have that perspective end up feeling differently about others. So we're not thinking, you know, the Ukrainians or the Russians or the Palestinians or the Israelis. We are all connected in a bigger way if we could just have that perspective that, yes, we do have our specific home and we do have a specific address on this earth, but we hold that lightly. We don't hold it where we feel like, okay, I'm never going to change home, or, you know, my home has to be exactly this way all the time, because we live on this incredible gift of the planet Earth, and we are part of this massive system. So thinking of another image, and this is from Voyager 2, I believe, this is when they looked at the Earth. This is the solar system. So this is, you know, again, a sliver of this big universe. And then you can't even see us. The Earth is that little in that perspective. So think about that perspective, that, what is it called, according to Carl Sagan, the pale blue dot, the pale blue dot. Thinking of us, that's where we are. And so whatever you are going through in life, whatever you might be aspiring to do, never lose track of this. Never lose sight of the fact that you belong here. I'm looking at you, Elizabeth, and thinking, you're the science gal I know in our congregation. And you always look, you know, you look at the big stuff, but you also look at the minute stuff. And it's incredible because it's the same kind of laws, and it's really that life is just replicated in the same way. Do you want to say anything about that? No? Because what? Tell them what you teach. Organic chemistry. Single atoms and all of that. But when you think about the single atoms and how things are, I mean, that you go to see the birth of stars, and you see the darkness and the supernovas and all of that, I'm thinking that looks very similar to pregnancy and giving birth. It's the same kind of stuff. It's the same patterns. And so this stuff is really incredible to reflect on and to put within the, not just the science piece, but also from the faith piece for us and the mystery of it all. And so what we're going to do to end, I see there's an end here, Don, is that we're going to keep these images in our minds. And what I've done is broken up the scripture and interspersed words from Carl Sagan, from his reflection on the pale blue dot. So I'll be reading the Carl Sagan parts, and you'll be reading the scripture, so you'll be the people part. So reflect on that and let God speak to you as to where you are in life right now. And so in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Look again at that dot. That's here. That's home. That's us. On it, everyone you love, everyone you know, everyone you ever heard of, every human being who ever was, lived out their lives. The aggregate of our joy and suffering, thousands of confident religions, ideologies, and economic doctrines, every hunter and forager, every hero and coward, every creator and destroyer of civilization, every king and peasant, every young couple in love, every mother and father, hopeful child, inventor and explorer, every teacher of morals, every corrupt politician, every superstar, every supreme leader, every saint and sinner in the history of our species lived there on a mote of dust suspended in a sunbeam. amen to that invitation to Christ's table. And so today we come invited because Christ is the host himself. We come invited as we are, as we experience life, and this is a place of belonging for us. It has become, in the Christian tradition, a place where we are all invited to share our joys, to share our failures, to share life as we know it, but especially to share the love of Christ. And so we come invited, all of us, those of us who are coming here for the first time, or those of us who have come here many times, those of us who have come here every time we hold communion, or those of us who are coming here for the first time in a long time. Whatever it is, you are all invited because Christ is the host himself, and this is his table of love. And so we remember that on the night of his arrest, our Lord Jesus Christ took the bread, and after giving thanks to God, he broke it, and he gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body broken for you." In the same way, he took the cup, and after giving thanks to God, he gave it to them, saying, "This cup is the new covenant, sealed in my blood, shed for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink from it, do this in remembrance of me." And so we give thanks today to God for these gifts, for the presence of Christ in these gifts, and the invitation to receive these gifts, to renew our lives. Let us pray. God, we give you thanks for these gifts, and we ask for your blessing upon them and upon us as we receive them, to experience the unity that we have with you, with one another, but also with all of your creation. May the brokenness of this table remind us how you come to us in the simple experiences of life, yet also in the majesty of all your creation. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. And so we come to receive these gifts, the bread of life, the cup of Christ's love, and we invite you to come forward, and so the elements will be at the table. I invite you to take a piece of bread and dip it in the cup, the communal cup, or take a small cup and partake as you feel moved. And there is a small bowl that has gluten-free elements for you, but if you would like to remain seated, I'm looking at Pam and Grace. They will be serving you as well. So come, for all is ready. And we give thanks. We give you thanks, O God, for meeting us in this way, for bringing us to your table. Help us to live in the days to come by the vision of unity and of love. Amen. And please join me as you are able, and standing and singing hymn number 467, How Great Thou Art.
Thank you.
and for the blessing. Remember, you didn't come here to master unconditional love. That is where you came from and where you'll return. You came here to learn personal love, universal love, messy love, crazy love, broken love, whole love, infused with divinity, lived through the grace of stumbling, demonstrated through the beauty of often messing up. You didn't come here to be perfect. You already are. You came here to be gloriously human, flawed and fabulous, and then to rise again into remembering. So stay present and feel fully, shine and fly, behold the beauty and wonder of this life. You belong, but never forget where you came from. Amen. Please turn to your neighbors and greet them with the peace of Christ.